Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Iron Butterfly by Chanda Hahn. Narrated by Jesse Vilinsky. Chapter 1. When I first awoke in the darkness that was my prison cell, I was brave, fearless, and I still had enough fight in me to question the rules. But after my third beating by Scarlet, I learned to hold my tongue in his presence. After my first taste of torture on the machine, I learned obedience. Down in this hell, silence was more than golden. It was the difference between life and death. And where we were, there was a whole lot of death. The sound of a distant door slamming snapped my mind back to the present. Footsteps slowed, and my cell door opened with an ominous creak. The light from the hall fell across my bruised face, making my eyes flinch in pain. A small whimper and the rustle of straw drew my attention to the other forgotten occupant of my cell, a small girl named Cammy. She pathetically tried to scoot away and put as much distance between her and the man about to enter our cell. My mouth formed the word, "No," as an ugly bulldog of a man ducked under the too short doorframe. I knew without looking it was Scarlet. He had a crooked nose, dark unwashed hair, and cruel black eyes that hid beneath a furrowed brow. He smiled in delight at Cammy's attempt to evade him, which made the pale scar that transected his top lip stand out. The smell that accompanied him was a mixture of sweat and rot, which permeated from the layers of dried and crusted blood that coated his blacksmith's apron. He had come to take one of us to Raven. Drips of sweat beaded across my forehead as the footsteps drew closer. It was too soon. I wasn't strong enough for another session on the machine. I groaned when I saw the smear of blood coating the back of my hand, left over from last night's experiment. I knew that if he chose me again, I wouldn't survive. I tried to raise my head from the cold stone floor as he came closer to stand over my prone form. But a sudden wave of fear made me vomit what little was left in my stomach. Scarlet paused over my dry, heaving body and backed away in disgust. When the convulsions stopped, I heard him move toward Cammy, and the sounds of scuffling as she crawled farther into the darkness of the cell, hoping its shadows would hide her from his gaze. It was no use. All she did was back herself into a corner. Cammy whimpered, "Please, don't," and was smacked in the face by Scarlet.
"No talking. You know the rules," he sneered.
Her lip quivered, and a small amount of blood appeared at the side of her mouth. She tried to wipe at it with the back of her hand, but only smeared it across her chin. She bit her bottom lip between her teeth to keep any more sound from coming forth.
"That's better," he growled. "The Raven has a new experiment to try and needs another volunteer."
Scarlet grabbed Cammy by the arms and dragged her out into the hall, her feet twisting and fighting behind her, trying to slow his efforts. She hadn't lost her fight. But if she survived the week in this pit, she would. I raised my hand toward them, as if by that one action alone I could protect her and stop what was about to happen. The large cell door shut with a thud, and I waited to hear whether the lock turned. It did. I counted the steps as Scarlet dragged Cammy up the stairs through another door, mentally tracing the intricate path they would take, until they reached a huge iron door that, once opened, would let out a smell of iron, sulfur, and death. I knew from experience that a table waited behind that door with cold iron shackles, and as well as... I shivered at the mental picture that formed of the nameless machine they used to experiment on us. When the sound of the door at the top of the stairs closed, the pain in my chest exploded because I was holding my breath. I cried in relief that I wasn't going to be tortured and experimented on again, that I survived one more day. I dropped my head to the floor and let the grief pour out of my body in loud, aching sobs, as I realized in shame that I was happy he chose Cammy. I woke to the familiar sound of a tin plate being shoved through the food slot in the bottom of the door and bolted upright in fear and anticipation. Hungrily, I snatched the small life-saving plate of food and dragged it far from the door to where Cammy slept. But where Cammy usually laid curled up in slumber, there only remained a tattered blanket and straw. I hung my head in shame. She wasn't strong enough to survive the experiments. Few were. I was one of the lucky ones, if you considered being tortured and beaten on a regular basis and survive being lucky. With an air of renewed determination, I peeked through the slot in the door and saw Boots covered by the blood-red robes of one of the Septori. He slowly made his way past the cells, delivering the morning's offerings of food to the other prisoners. I hunched by the slot, waiting for him to pass my way. When he came within reach, I snaked my hand out and grabbed the hem of his robe. He stumbled to a halt. Gathering my voice, I croaked out, "Cammy! What did you do with Cammy?" He sneered at me and tried to dislodge my hand from his robe. My increasing courage only added volume to my voice. "What did you do with her? If you hurt her, I'll..."
"You'll what?" he interrupted. "You haven't succeeded so far in protecting any of the others, so why now?"
He kicked my hand away from his ankle and stepped on my wrist, pinning it to the floor before I could yank it under the flap. He leaned down, putting pressure on my injured wrist as I gritted my teeth and sucked in my breath against the pain. He peered at me under the flap, and I could see the bottom half of his face and the crooked teeth that lined his sneering mouth. This one was known as Crow. Knowing his name somehow made him seem less terrifying.
"Don't worry about your friend."
Crow spoke slowly, cruelly.
"She has outlived her usefulness to the Raven. He was extremely disappointed in her results. She lacked..." "What did he say?" "Oh yes, the determination to live. Unlike you. The Raven was displeased that you weren't able to help him last night."
Cocking his head to the side like a bird, he went on,
"He was quite angry and unnecessarily took it out on the girl. So in fact, what happened to her is your fault."
His eyes lit up with joy in sharing the news. He used his dirty fingernail to dig at one of my barely healed wounds until blood began to pool. I could see the red raised skin of the brand that marked him for a member of the Septori. Two slash marks within a circle.
"Such a pity that she didn't have your strength. But few do."
He slowly raised his hand covered in my blood to his mouth.
"What a waste."
He moved away, releasing the pressure on my pinned wrist. I yanked it back into the darkness of my cell, away from the taint of being touched by one of the hated and vile Septori. I was horrified and disgusted at what he had done. "You lie!" I yelled uselessly at the locked cell door.
"Do I?"
Crow's voice crept through.
"You will learn soon enough. You may even see firsthand what's left of her when the Raven sends for you tonight. And make no mistake, he will send for you tonight."
His evil laugh echoed behind him as he walked up the stairs. Normally, those words would turn me into a terrified bundle of nerves. But I was too shocked by what had just happened and the news of Cammy's death. I knew better than to get emotionally attached to the other prisoners. I had learned my lesson after my first cellmate. I closed myself off after that as numerous girls came and went. None of them were as strong as me. But this one was different. She was different. A loud droning noise filled my ears, and I placed my hands over them to make it stop. Then I realized I was making the noise, and it was only getting louder with my pain.
"Control yourself,"
a deep male voice barked from down the hall.
"You can't fall all to pieces down here if you want to live."
The noise just became higher pitched with hiccups as I tried to control the sound.
Cammy's dead,
I stuttered out.
It's my fault. If I were stronger, I could have. I should have.
Hush,
Tim whispered from across the hall.
There's nothing you could have done. You should be happy it wasn't you. If you don't quiet down and stop talking, they'll hear you, and then they will come back.
A week ago, his brother had never returned to his cell after a night with the machine. I hadn't heard him utter a word since. He had withdrawn into his own pain.
It doesn't matter,
spoke the first voice.
Let them come.
It was a voice I didn't recognize, so I assumed this must be the new prisoner they'd brought in a few days ago, and it was the first time he'd been coherent enough to speak.
Who are you? I asked.
No one,
he muttered.
If we are going to die down here, I would at least like to know your name,
I pleaded into the echoing halls.
Kale.
I'm Thalia,
I said with a small smile.
Why are you here? Why were you drugged for so long? Are you someone important?
The questions came sputtering out.
Someone important?
He made a snort.
No. They've kept me drugged because they know that I will eventually kill them all.
Can you do it? Can you break out and take us with you?
The desperation rang in my voice. A long silence followed, and I prayed that Kale was planning an escape.
No.
I didn't expect his painful answer. I felt tears of disappointment burn at my eyes, but I wiped them away with the back of my dirty hand. My world crumbled around me once again, as my hopes of ever leaving were dashed.
I could if I were stronger. I'm a Denai. Or was.
Tim interrupted sadly.
I can barely shift anything since they brought me here. Wherever we are. Hell!
Kale spoke gruffly.
It's the drugs, I whispered. It blocks all of your power and gifts, like it did to Cammy.
If only Sal were still here,
Tim whined.
He would know what to do.
A moment of silence followed before Tim became talkative again.
Why are we here?
I don't know.
We could only speculate at what the Septori's motives were behind these painful experiments. I had never seen Raven's true face, for he hid behind a silver hook-nosed mask and a robe. The sound of his raspy breath and his hollow-eyed mask haunted my dreams each night.
What did I ever do to deserve this? I shouldn't be here,
Tim argued. I knew he was confused and rambling, but it was becoming annoying.
I don't know. Why are any of us here? I muttered. I started to wind my dark hair around my finger, a nervous habit. Just then, a loud pounding sound came from the cell down the hall. Thud, clang, thud, thud, clang. It sounded like Kale was throwing himself against the door and pounding his plate against the lock. You aren't going to open the lock with that plate, I remarked dryly.
Don't need to. Just need to get their attention, Kale grunted between throws. What?
Tim hissed.
You can't be serious. You want them to come?
His voice changed to a higher pitch as his nervous laughter got the better of him.
He wants them to come down here? They're gonna be mad. They're gonna beat us.
Please don't. My body started to shake at the thought of the beatings we would receive for breaking the rules. I could handle the pain. I couldn't handle the machine.
I don't want to go back into that room.
Now my voice was quavering.
I can't take it anymore.
Hoping my pleas didn't fall on deaf ears, I pressed my body against the cold door and prayed. The noise stopped for an instant as if he heard me, and then picked up again with a desperate fervor. He interspersed the banging of the plate with kicking, pounding, and yelling. I pressed my back to the cell door, slid down to the floor, and resigned myself to the painful punishment that would be doled out to all of us equally.
What's going on?
Scarlet yelled as he opened the door, followed by three sets of loud footsteps. He brought the guards. I ducked to the floor and lifted the metal flap to try and see where he was heading. None of the Septori in their robes appeared. I wondered briefly where they were.
Over here, you moron! I have information that your master wants.
Kale had immediately directed Scarlet's attention onto himself, instead of Tim and me. The armed men rushed to the cell and gathered around Kale's door. Scarlet halted suspiciously outside Kale's cell door.
What is the information that you have for him? Is it valuable?
He asked.
Oh, it's life-changing, all right.
Scarlet licked his lips in anticipation.
What is it that you want me to know?
I thought it imperative that your master knows.
Kale paused for effect.
That you are a slimy, no-good, rotten toad. A bastard son of a flea-ridden donkey. Quiet!
Scarlet hissed.
You can't even think for yourself. You grovel so much to the raven, I think you must like the taste of dirt.
Shut up!
Scarlet pounded on the door.
Or you'll be sorry. I'll make you wish you'd never been born.
I'm already sorry. I'm sorry that I'm subjected to seeing your ugly face every day. You know, only a dog or a mother could love that face. No, I'm wrong. Your mother must be a dog to love the likes of you.
Kale taunted. That did it. Scarlet grabbed the keys from his belt with his thick fingers and shoved one into the lock. The other guards grabbed their clubs and entered one by one into the cell. But all I saw was the dust cloud made from the scuffling of their feet. I heard fighting and grunting, and I hoped Kale was the one dealing the punches. Finally, the fighting stopped. The dust settled, and I saw Scarlet emerge from the cell with a victorious smirk on his face. Following behind him were two of the guards, dragging Kale between them by his forearms. The third guard trailed behind. Kale was either dead or unconscious. Long, dark hair covered most of his face, but a blue headband over his forehead was visible. His body was long, lean, and well-muscled, if a bit thin. In his current weakened condition, it had been suicide to try and take on all of the men at once. Based on his dirty and torn clothes, he was either a hired sword or a mercenary.
"Let's give him a session on the machine,"
Scarlet roared angrily.
"But we're not supposed to enter Raven's workshop when he's not there,"
a nervous guard spoke up.
"Shut up, you idiot,"
a second guard intervened.
"No one will know but us.
And believe me, this one needs another lesson in obedience."
As they drew closer to my cell, I started to feel an intense pressure in my mind, a headache that pulsed at my temples. I closed my eyes to stop the pressure, and I almost missed Kale spring to life. Kale, who I thought was unconscious, moved in a flash and grabbed the knife from the guard's belt. He thrust the blade upward into the guard's throat, sinking the blade into the hilt. As Kale pulled it out, the guard released his arm and fell to the ground, choking, his life ebbing away. Before the guard even hit the ground, Kale had gained his footing and slashed at the man holding his other arm. The downward arc forced the other guard to release him. The rear guard rushed him, swinging his short sword. Kale's smaller blade made it look like he was playing with a toy. Kale jumped back, missing the blow of the short sword, as he adjusted the weight of the confiscated knife in his hand. When the sword swung at him again, Kale ducked and rushed forward to take the brunt force of the sword handle on his shoulder. Wrapping his hand around the rear guard's arm, he rammed the handle of the knife into the man's temple, knocking him unconscious. Scarlet screamed obscenities at the last guard.
"Grab him, you fool! What are you doing? Hit him! Don't let him up!"
All the while keeping a safe distance. But Kale was bleeding from his shoulder wound, and he was still outnumbered 2-1, and tiring quickly. The second guard, also bleeding from a slash on his arm, carefully stalked Kale, trying to push him back toward his opened cell. He pulled out a dagger from his boot and picked up the dead guard's knife. There was no way Kale could take out the guard with a knife and short sword, unless he threw his dagger, giving up his only weapon. The pain in my head became unbearable.
"Do something!" I yelled at Tim.
"I'll try,"
Tim answered. Tim reached his hand under the grate and grabbed at the uniform of the guard. A flash of light appeared, and the guard's clothes caught on fire. He screamed in panic and dropped both weapons to bat at his burning uniform. Kale rushed the burning guard and elbowed him in the throat. The guard sputtered and dropped to his knees. Kale punched him in the face, knocking him out cold. As soon as the guard lost consciousness, the flames about him disappeared. A small squeal escaped Scarlet's mouth, and he turned white with fright, as he realized he was the only one left to face the deadly Kale. Scarlet turned to run up the stairs as Kale threw the dagger. The silver blade sunk into Scarlet's back, and he fell over with a grunt, sliding down the stairs and coming to a halt on the bottom step. Kale ran over and retrieved the keys from Scarlet's still body and ran to Tim's cell. He quickly unlocked the door, and a wide-eyed Tim emerged, shaking.
"Did you see that? I did it! I helped!" he sputtered.
"Thanks," Kale quickly shouted. "But you have to get out of here, and quick!"
Tim wasted no time and shot up the stairs and down the corridor toward freedom. Kale unlocked my cell. As the door swung open, I could see his face close up for the first time, and my heart fluttered with apprehension. Here was someone who wasn't afraid to die. A fierce look came from stormy blue eyes that were partially obscured by long, dark hair. Kale's hard mouth was set in a firm line as he studied me. He looked beyond me into the darkness of my cell, searching for an ambush or possibly another prisoner. Kale appeared older than me by a few years, but was striking and fierce at the same time. Here was a man bred to be a warrior. I knew what he would find in me. A short little thing, more like a child than an adult. My height stopped a few inches over 5 feet, and I was small compared to his towering frame. My hair hung dark and limp down my back, and my blue eyes must look sickly surrounded by my swollen face and bruises. His expression was grim and determined as he reached for my arm, and then stopped, his hand inches away.
"Come on,"
he growled, curling his fingers into a fist at his side. I ignored his gruff demeanor. After all, I didn't know him, and he did rescue me. I tried to stand, but all I was able to do was take a few steps, and then stumble into the door. I was weak from malnourishment, and the intense pounding in my head made me feel awkward and unbalanced. Kale inhaled his breath as if he were holding it, and stepped back, not bothering to assist me.
"Get going,"
he snapped. The tone of his voice made me stiffen in resistance. I squared my shoulders and ordered him about. "Well, then move out of the doorway." Kale moved to the side, letting me pass before he reached for a torch from a wall. He entered each of the open cells and gathered all of the blankets, clothes, and straw into a corner to make kindling. Once done, he set them ablaze. He deftly stepped over the dead and unconscious guards and moved to the hall. The hungry, crackling fire would soon spread to the wooden door and along the support beams in the wall. I hoped it would bring the whole thing down. I stood watching him work until I had a prickling sensation on the back of my neck. Then I moved as fast as my feet would take me up the stairs and out the first door, not bothering to notice that the stairs were empty of a body that was previously there. I hurried down the corridor to where the passageway split. To my left, I could smell the air of freedom. But to my right, down the other dark corridor, stood the huge metal door of the laboratory, and possibly Cammy. I started to take steps away from potential freedom when Kale loomed up behind me.
"No, leave it well alone."
"Get out of here,"
he yelled, as he dragged the still form of an unconscious guard after him. The other guard must not have survived.
"But Cammy could be down there."
"You get outside. I'll go look for her."
He propped the guard against the wall and ran toward the laboratory. Nodding my head in assent, I silently made my way down the opposite passageway, realizing that I hadn't been eager in the least to travel the other one. I followed the passageway by feeling the wall with my hand, wishing I had thought to grab a torch. The wood beams became sparse, and the ceiling slanted lower and lower until I was feeling the crossbeams skim the top of my head. Anyone taller would have to duck to traverse the same path. My hands started to get entangled in roots that protruded from the wall. The gloom of the passageway seemed to go on forever until I encountered a wall of dirt. Feeling a moment of panic, I felt around in the darkness for a door or handle, anything to help me escape. Something rough brushed against my face, and I squeaked in surprise. Touching the object, I found it to be a rope that dangled from the ceiling. Following the rope up with my hands, I found that it was attached to a trap door in the ceiling. By now, the darkness was being lightened by the glow of red flames behind me. I pushed the wooden door, and it barely moved an inch. I was so weak. It took me 3 tries to push it open, but I still had to pull myself out of the tunnel. Smoke began to fill the air, and it stung my watering eyes. My body weight felt impossible to lift. "Come on," I cried aloud. I scratched the ground for purchase, trying to find any handhold to assist me. I finally dragged my chest up onto the dirt floor, bruising my ribs in the process. I wasn't sure what I was expecting when I emerged, but it wasn't a stable. The trap door was carefully hidden in the back stall under straw. The whole prison and experimental lab was housed and camouflaged by a stable. The smell of the horses would definitely cover the smell of the prison, experiments, and death. Standing to my feet, I brushed my dirt-caked hands on my shirt and looked around for a means of faster escape. I glanced back down into the trapdoor, looking for signs of Kale or Cammy. But the passageway was empty, except for the faint glow of fire and a trail of smoke pouring out of it. There were 8 wooden stalls in the stable. 6 were empty. I knew the raven wasn't here because Scarlet had said so. And I hadn't seen any of the cursed Septori. Where were they? Somewhere close? Or did they build a stable out in the middle of nowhere for this purpose? No. There had to be another building close by. I wasn't sure, but I didn't think the prison seemed big enough to house all of the Septori and guards. If they were in a nearby shelter, they would see the smoke and soon be upon us. 2 horses were still stabled, and were starting to panic as more smoke poured in through the trapdoor. There were signs that a 3rd had been here not too long ago. Tim had been smart enough to grab a mount. Running to the wall, I grabbed the bridle from a hook and tried to put the bay's tack on. My hands shook so much that I kept fumbling with the cinch. Once finished, I reached for the roan's bridle. I wouldn't have time for saddles. I was tiring quickly, and I didn't have the strength to hoist the saddles onto the horses' backs. My foot slipped in something warm and wet. Looking down, I saw that I had stepped in a small pool of blood. Horror and shock froze me, momentarily. But the jerking of the horses pulled my attention back to the dire situation. Ignore the blood. Get out of here. Now. I struggled to keep both horses under control as I led them out of the stable into the darkening night. The crackling fire and the pungent smell of smoke were getting closer, making the horses panic. The sound of a rushing river caught my ear, and I half-pulled, half-sweet-talked the horses toward the water, away from the fire. But once they caught sight of the water, they dragged me the rest of the way. Looking over my shoulder toward the stable, I prayed that Kale would hurry up and get out of there. I reached the riverbed, dropped to my knees, and leaned down to wash the dirt from my hands. Cupping my hands, I drank the water down in huge gulps, the cold making my empty stomach cramp. But my stomach pain was soon an afterthought as I felt the cool prick of a knife at my throat. I froze, hands to my side, still kneeling by the riverbed, the rocks digging into my knees painfully. Too scared to turn my head, my eyes followed the blade of a knife to Scarlet's shaking body. He was angry, bloody and sputtering in rage.
You little brat. He's going to hold me responsible.
Scarlet grabbed me around the throat with his free hand and began to squeeze.
But you...
His voice became cold, hard.
Are the one who's going to pay, just like the boy.
My mind flashed to the drops of blood I saw in the stable. Scarlet had killed Tim. Wildly, I clawed at Scarlet's huge hands and tried to pry them from around my neck, to no avail. Dropping one hand, I dug frantic fingers into the dirt, looking for anything that could be used as a weapon. My fingers wrapped around a small rock. White specks danced before my eyes. I was running out of time. And how strange. My constant headache had finally disappeared. In a final act of desperation, I swung the rock at his head. Scarlet yelled, dropping the knife into the river. Gasping for breath, I scrambled to my feet. My hands reached for my bruising throat. It ached, and I had trouble swallowing and catching my breath. I turned to look for Scarlet, when a huge branch came out of the darkness toward my head. White, blinding pain filled my conscience. Spinning with the force of the blow, I fell backwards into the fast-moving river. The coldness made me gasp for breath, and water filled my mouth, making me choke. I glimpsed the starry night turning bright with orange fire, just before my world turned pitch black. Chapter 2. The smell of cooking meat and the sound of a crackling campfire brought me slowly to awareness. That, and the small stone that was stabbing my lower back with a vengeance. Being very careful not to change the rhythm of my breathing, I listened and tried to take stock of my surroundings through lowered lashes. I was laid out on a bedroll, underneath the open sky, with a cloak rolled up under my head. The scent of sweat, spice, and horse mingled together and assailed my nose. The sound of numerous horses nickering warned me of the possibility of multiple people in the camp. I looked for any signs of the Septori or Scarlet. A brown-haired, middle-aged man wearing the most flamboyant outfit I had ever seen was tending a small fire. He was arrayed in patchwork blues, yellow, and white. The clothing was wrapped so intricately, I couldn't tell where one swatch began and another stopped. Light tan leather boots went up his calves and ended with ornately decorated designs of swirls and flourishes. I was staring so hard that I missed someone leaning over me until a shadow covered my face.
"Well, Darren, it looks like our little fish is awake,"
the shadow spoke. All pretense of feigning sleep vanished as I found myself confronted with the most handsome young man I'd ever seen. I took in the wind-blown, sandy blonde hair and dimpled smile. His deep green eyes were pools of emotions. Worry, kindness, hope were so evident in them that I soon lost all thought of being afraid. He was beautiful. Too beautiful to be human. His attractiveness left me stunned and gaping wide-mouthed, like the fish he had moments before called me.
"How are you doing?"
His strong fingers went to my brow to adjust the bandage that was wrapped around my head. I flinched with the contact. He made shushing noises as I tried to protest the cup of water he was putting to my lips. But once the cool water touched my throat, I grasped his hand and drank greedily, moaning in protest when he pulled it away.
"Nope, that's enough. I'm sure you have plenty of questions, and we have some for you. But let me assure you, first and foremost, that you are safe, and we won't harm you. What's your name?"
"Thalia." I paused as I racked my brain helplessly for more, but that's all I was able to give him.
"Well, Thalia, you can call me Joss. The funny-looking man burning the soup is Darren Hamden."
He gestured to the brightly decorated man I was staring at earlier. My eyes skimmed Joss's outfit and saw that he, too, was dressed in finely tailored clothes, though not as exuberant as Darren's clothes.
"Where are we?" I implored.
"Well, we are currently in Calandry," he said as he pointed across the river. "Right over there is Sinindor, if that is where you would like to be."
I stared blankly at Joss, waiting for him to elaborate. He bobbed his head as he hurriedly tried to explain.
"We stopped to water the horses and found you, injured and burning with fever on the riverbank."
Joss nodded in Darren's direction.
"Darren thought maybe you had a run-in with some of Sinindor's elite."
I knew very little of Sinindor. It was a country run by a king that hated all Denai. So the Denai stayed clear of their borders and the bloodthirsty king. But accidents happen. And sometimes Sinindor's bloodline wasn't always as pure as the king hoped. Those with mixed blood tried to escape at night to Calandry, where all races were welcome. Most never made it past the border guards, or the elite.
Sinindor's fiercest warriors patrolled and killed anyone trying to enter or leave the country on sight. Their sole purpose was to keep the scourge of the impure out of the country and kill those with it trying to leave. Joss interrupted my thoughts.
We don't care much for the King of Sinindor, or how they run things. But that wouldn't stop us from offering help.
The look he gave me was a questioning one, as if he himself was still trying to figure out where I fit in.
You were unconscious, so I took the liberty of healing your wounds.
So, you are a Denai? I looked at him, surprised. Joss nodded yes. In embarrassment, he looked down at the ground before looking back up at me, and it made me realize he was probably only a year older than me. Taking a quick breath, he went on.
You had intensive internal injuries, and I wasn't able to heal everything. So there will be scarring.
He looked solemn and nodded to my arms. I glanced at my arms and saw that the cuts, burns, and scars had faded to faint silvery lines. Before, they had been a deep infected red. The bruises were gone. I hadn't felt so good in a long time. But I felt a cold sweat start to break out at the thought of Joss using power on me while I was unconscious. It was too similar to what the Septori had done. I quelled the fear in the pit of my stomach and swallowed my pride. I nodded to Joss in answer. Let him be. Scars can heal in their own time. I was about to say more when Darren brought over a bowl of broth with small chopped up vegetables in it. My stomach growled over the broth, and I immediately started drinking it right out of the bowl. I finished with only letting a little dribble down my chin, my gaze drawn to the meat roasting over the fire. When was the last time I had tasted meat?
Well, well, well,
Darren laughed.
Hungry little thing, isn't she? Don't worry. You can have more broth in a little bit. It needs to settle to see if it's going to stay down before you can have more.
He caught my gaze drifting to the meat again. His demeanor became more serious as he politely explained.
Your body isn't ready for meat yet, little one. It will just come back up.
I took in his appearance now that he was closer, and I saw the neatly trimmed triangle of hair under his bottom lip. He sported one gold hoop earring with a single blue bead that added to the carefree rover look of him.
Why don't you explain how you ended up in the river? And then we will give you some more broth, eh?
Darren interrupted. My thoughts immediately flashed back to my time as a prisoner, and I began to shake uncontrollably.
No, no,
Darren said.
It's okay. But I think it will get easier if you face your fears and talk about it.
Glancing at Joss, I saw that he had become quiet and sat back, as if steeling himself for the news. I shrugged my shoulders in indifference. I'll talk as long as Darren keeps my bowl filled. Darren's bold laughter eased the tension as he shook my hand to seal the deal. Even though their friendly manners made me want to trust them, I wasn't ready to give them the whole truth. I was still a lone woman amongst two strangers, and who knew? They might have lied about who they were. Maybe they were even part of Sinindor's elite. I decided to play it safe. I was running away, and I slipped and fell in the river. I couldn't look either of them in the eye as I said it. Darren's brows drew together, and he frowned. It was as if he could sense my lie. And he pulled the bowl of broth back toward him, away from my grasp.
Sorry, girlie. I wasn't born yesterday. That's not the whole truth.
Yes, it is, I countered. I fell in.
I'd wager there's more to it than that. So tell me, what were you running away from?
I couldn't help it. My gaze darted over their shoulder to check for signs of hooded robes. Darren took a deep breath, kneeled in front of me, and very gently put his rough hand on my shoulder.
Thalia, it is obvious that you are scared of something, or someone. The state that we found you in spoke of more than just falling in a river. You show the signs of long-term abuse. And even though you just met us, I assure you that we will do everything in our power to keep you safe.
Darren's voice spoke truth, and I felt the protective wall I had built start to crumble. The Septori. I was taken by the Septori. I choked out in a barely audible voice. This time it was Darren and Joss's turn to look at me in confusion. They are a cult, led by a horrible leader we only knew as the Raven. My hands began to shake, and I dug my fingernails painfully into my palms in an attempt to quell the hatred that rushed me. They kidnapped, tortured, and performed brutal experiments on us. I was lucky to escape with my life. Most didn't. They are a heartless group of red-robed monsters, I spat out. My palms stung, so I looked down. Fresh blood coated my fingernails. Feeling slightly ashamed that I had re-injured myself, I tucked my hands under my arms and looked at the ground. I hoped Joss wouldn't notice my self-inflicted injury and want to heal me. He didn't. He sat back in shock. I don't think he was prepared for what I had said.
What were they trying to accomplish?
He asked. I really don't know and don't care. And I would prefer not to wait around until they find me. I glanced around the camp in urgency to see what I could find that could be used as weapons. Joss and Darren were hardly prepared for an attack. But I can tell you this. There were others with me, even Denai. If they could be captured, there is no doubt that the Septori could take on you too as well. I tried to make my voice as steady and determined as possible, so that they would understand the seriousness of what I was saying.
How did you come to be with them?
Darren asked, as he filled my bowl with more soup. I watched as he only filled it a quarter of the way full. I gave him a pointed stare, but he refused to add any more to my bowl. I can't remember. I only remember waking up bound and gagged in a dark, dank, windowless cell with two other girls. I was the only one who couldn't remember anything about my previous life. I held out my bowl to Darren. He stared at me before shaking himself and refilling my bowl. This time it was almost full. He kept reassuring me that I would be safe. I don't know if we were purposely chosen, or kidnapped, or if we were bartered away. But all of us down there were experiments. The two girls I originally shared the cell with disappeared within a week. Others came and went. I was the only one they couldn't kill or break.
What did they do to you with these experiments?
Joss asked. I dug my fingernails into my wet palms, and my chest felt like it would explode. My breaths came in shallow gasps. All of the control that I had carefully gathered waned as fear took over. Darren saw my panicked face and intervened.
Joss.
He spoke quietly.
Maybe you don't want to know. Some things are best left unspoken.
Refusing to make eye contact, I turned my head and decided that I wasn't going to say any more, no matter how many times they filled my bowl up. Joss jumped up in anger, throwing his tin cup into the fire.
The splash of liquid on the flames made it sputter, and I jumped in surprise.
I wish that you were making it up,
he fumed. I stiffened at the comment and looked at him in confusion.
I'm not. I could never make up something as awful as that.
No, I believe you. I just don't want to admit there are people as cruel and evil as that in our country. I know that you are indeed speaking the truth, because I have seen the evidence. Maybe you really were in Sinindor and didn't know it.
He began to pace back and forth, his anger evident in his posture and the clenching of his fists. But the way he did everything bespoke a natural grace. I watched him pace as I asked myself the question I'd plagued myself with for weeks. Why was I there in the first place? I didn't understand why the Septori hadn't let me go. Of course, deep down, I knew the reason. The Raven would never let me go, because I had seen too much. The only way I would be leaving that prison would be if I were in a wooden box. And then I started to dwell on Cammy, and how I sent Kale back for her. He was probably dead because of me. The guilt overwhelmed me, and I buried my head in my knees, wrapping my arms around them for comfort. Even rocking back and forth didn't help. It was too much. The shock was finally wearing off, and I could feel again. But the feelings and emotions were too much. They were consuming me. A few choked sobs escaped my lips as I rocked faster. Joss and Darren glanced at each other in total helplessness.
Don't look at me, Darren said to Joss. Malani said I'm useless when it comes to understanding or comforting the female kind.
Joss kneeled next to me and tried to put his hand on my back. I stiffened in fright and spat out, Don't touch me! He dropped his hand dejectedly to his side and reached for an extra blanket to wrap around my shoulders instead. I could tell by the look in his eyes I had hurt his feelings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.